Assalamu alaikum, I am Misha again. If you like my channel, then please subscribe it. I'm here to elaborate another topic which is named as pterobranchia. Pterobranchia is actually the fusion of two words having Greek origin. Pteron mean wings or feather and branchia mean gills.
It is a very small class of hemichordate. I think it's better to talk about some introductory information about this class. Why don't we talk about the distribution and location? So it is distributed everywhere in the world, in deep oceans and seas, especially in southern hemisphere. You can also find them in European coastal waters, especially across the Bermuda Triangle. The number of species are not so great. Only 20 species are present in this phylum, and their size ranges from 0.1 to 5 millimeter. And if you talk about its exclusive habitat, they are present in the tubes which are actually secreted by their own during asexual reproduction, when they are supposed to produce colonies of their own. Moving forward toward morphology, you have seen that these organisms are following the basic trend which have set earlier by Enterobranchia. But still, you can find a lot of differences or noticeable differences in their structure. For example, when we talk about their structure, their body is divided into three main regions. The very first region is the proboscis. But here comes the first difference. Their proboscis is not elongated, not conical. Instead, they have expanded shield-like proboscis. For your information, shield is a structure which the ancient warrior used to wear with their sword during war. So they use their proboscis for the purpose of their defense. And the other function is that their proboscis is responsible for the formation of tube, or you may say secretion of tube. You can see the clear cut pipe like structure around these organisms, which are actually the tubes of their colony. And these tubes are secreted during asexual reproduction. This tube is very, very important for these organisms because, as you all know, the proboscis is the retractable structure. Whenever they want, they can move back towards their tube and hide themselves completely in these tubes. And when the conditions become favorable, they are allowed to move forward by moving their proboscis outside these tubes. After proboscis, the second part is the collar. Here is the second difference. The collar structure is very, very much different. The collar contains a different number of arms. Their number varies from 2 to 9. And these arms contain numerous ciliated tentacles on it. These ciliated tentacles are responsible for gathering food and moving it towards the mouth. And the last structure is trunk, which is actually elongated, but due to its folding, it makes these organisms a U-shaped appearance.
This is a very good diagram of a pterobranchial colony, which is made up of three tubes. At number one tube, you can see a fully grown organism. At the anterior region, a proboscis is present. Behind the proboscis, a collar having two arms and a lot of tentacles is present, and the trunk is present inside this tube. At the last portion of trunk contain anus. These tubes contain stalk. You can see the shaded, the long, elongated thread-like structure behind the proboscis, behind the trunk region. This stalk is actually responsible for the connection of all colony. Every organism is connected through its stalk with the other organism.
Instead of all their morphological advancement, they still have the oldest maintenance functions retained in their body. Let's talk about the feeding. They have the simplest mechanism of feeding, which is none other than the filter feeding. And the structure which is responsible for filter feeding is the cilia present on their arms. These cilia are responsible for feeding by generating water current when they are moving. And the due to the water current, the food present in the suspended form in water move towards these organisms' body, and then they trap these food particle and move it towards the mouth. This is the simplest way of feeding. Excretion and respiration is also very simple. They have two mechanisms of excretion and respiration. Number one is through pharyngeal slits. Some organisms have a pair of pharyngeal slits which have same mechanism of respiration and excretion across the body, across the pharyngeal slits, which I have talked about earlier. And the other mechanism is diffusion across the body, as these organisms continually live in the water, and there is no wonder that they don't have any excretory and respiratory structure. So the gaseous waste and nitrogenous waste can easily move across their body through diffusion. How comes their reproduction and development? This is a worth asking question, because every organism have to reproduce to increase its number. These organisms can reproduce both asexually as well as sexually. And for asexual reproduction, they are adapted the mechanism of budding. Of course, budding is very common in these organisms, and the colonies of these organisms are produced due to budding. You have seen the colonies of these organisms in the previous diagram. The colony is formed of different pipes which are jointed through their bases, and their anterior portions are separated. For sexual reproduction, these organisms have one or two gonads present in their anterior trunk, and of course they have separate males and females body, and you can call that they are dioecious organisms. The first fertilization is mostly external, but the mechanism is a little bit tricky. They can retain their egg inside their tube but outside their body, and the sperms are move in the water. The sperm moves toward the egg and fertilize the egg. After fertilization, planula larva is produced. This planula larva for some time live inside the mother body, and after that this non-feeding larva eventually leaves the mother's body and settle onto a substrate for metamorphosis. After metamorphosis, these organisms are converted into the adult.